This is the Nvidia RTX 5070 Ti, and it trends in the same direction as the rest of the RTX 50 series so far. Is that a reason to be mad at it or dismiss it? Not really. It's still a solid 1440p GPU that sees a bump in raw performance over the previous generation, and it has a whole bag of 50 series tricks. But is there more to the RTX 50 series story here that the 5070 Ti tells us? Well, we're going to tell you all about that and more right here, right now, on Robeytech, after a word from our sponsors.
Another innovation from Main Gear that I cannot wait to get my hands on is the new Apex Rush. This is a PC that lives at the intersection of artistry and engineering. Featuring RTX 50 series graphics, the Apex Rush is gorgeous and powerful, but it also has some practical features that set it apart, from easily accessible filling and drain ports to multiple customization options and symmetrical cooling runs. The Apex Rush, it takes Main Gear's obsession with clean lines, cool components, and sheer simplicity to create one showstopper of a PC, and I cannot wait for you to check it out. But if you want more details right now, check out Apex Rush over on maingear.com today, or check out the link in the description below.
Right out of the gate, let's acknowledge the Damien in the room. Hi, that's me. If you've been around the channel, you've probably heard the name or you've caught a glimpse of me in some B-roll, but if you haven't, I can confidently say if you've watched a Robeytech video in the past 2 years, you've heard me speak, at least in Robey's voice. I'm typically behind the scenes as the Robeytech team's lead writer, but I'm in front of the camera today to make sure that you have a video and that Robey can actually take a vacation, because I don't know a dude who hustles as hard as that guy. So grab your favorite beverage and pull up a cozy seat, because I like words and I have a lot of them to share with you today. Right up front, I'm gonna tell you what we saw with the RTX 5070 Ti. It's a solid 1440p GPU that takes the generational baton from the 4070 Ti Super and does one of those like jazzercise power walks with it, where it's like not a walk or a run, but like they're going real hard at it. Like, it has both raw and enhanced performance over the past generation, and it does this in a $749 package. Well, I say a $749 package, but at the time of recording, we were seeing a $900+ price tag. I know that there's a whole lot of like, trust me bro, dripping from these statements, because we haven't given you any real data yet. But I wanted to give you like the 50,000 foot view as we begin our descent into the details. Before we can get there, we need to do two things. Thing number one is to say thank you to Nvidia for sending us the Asus Prime RTX 5070 Ti for review. And thing number two is a bit of housekeeping, and there's a lot of housekeeping here. Before we get to the numbers, I need to give you the same reminder that we've been giving you throughout the 50 series launch. All the numbers you're about to see are not concrete numbers. The drivers we use to test the RTX 5070 Ti are pre-release drivers specifically for the RTX 5070 Ti. So the data is going to be as sound as we can make it, but understand that something as simple as a driver update can shift results. Another reminder here, and if you saw our 5080 review, you would have heard this there as well. We're using a test bench powered by the Intel Core Ultra 9 285K. While we were preparing for the 50 series launch, we were short on 9800X3Ds, and we had some conversations as a team about whether the 9800X3D would introduce performance altering factors or quirks into our data, and as it turns out, we have some of those anyway. We'll talk about one of those in just a minute. Basically, the test data you'll see in our video is going to look different from data gathered using platforms powered by the Ryzen 7 9800X3D or Core i9-14900K. But hey, for all of you out there running Core Ultra systems, now you have a proxy for how a GPU like this will work in a system like yours. With the housekeeping done, a quick comment on what specifically we're going to be looking at today. For data comparisons, we're going to be using the Asus Prime RTX 5070 Ti as our 5070 Ti. For comparison, we'll be using the Nvidia RTX 4070 Ti Super, represented by the Gigabyte RTX 4070 Ti Super Eagle OC, as well as the AMD Radeon RX 7900 XT Reference Edition. We'll be looking at 1080p and 1440p raw data first, and then adding in DLSS and FSR, followed by applying frame generation and fluid motion frames. When we look at frame generation, we're only using the 5070 Ti's multi-frame generation at 2x to best match the 4070 Ti Super and the 7900 XT. With all of that done and dusted, let's get to the data. Starting with raw performance at 1080p, we saw the RTX 5070 Ti take around a 7.5% average lead over the 4070 Ti Super and while trading ground with the RX 7900 XT. But don't count that last one as a victory yet. Here we saw the most significant generational uplifts in games like Forza Horizon 5, Black Myth Wukong, and Cyberpunk 2077. These leads were in the double digits percentage-wise and span an uplift of 8 to 29 frames per second. Meanwhile, the 4070 Ti Super was far less willing to give up ground in Space Marine 2 and Hogwarts Legacy. We did have some of the usual suspects causing problems for the 5070 Ti when the 7900 XT entered the chat. Modern Warfare 3, Hogwarts, and Indiana Jones were all troublemakers, but there is more of a story here than what's in the charts. First off, we know that COD loves AMD, which, hey, good for all of you COD players out there. So this is unsurprising to us. As for Indiana Jones, this is where one of those quirks I mentioned earlier came into play. When we looked at the 4070 Ti and 5070 Ti data relative to the 7900 XT, the difference was so wildly vast that we had to figure out what was going on. After several retests, we slid both the 4070 Ti and 5070 Ti into a 14900K test bench. And wouldn't you know it, we saw a major difference in performance. And we're not talking a few frames here. We're talking about over 100 frames per second more at 1080p and close to 90 at 1440p. That said, we saw performance scaling stay largely the same between the 4070 Ti and 5070 Ti. The Radeon RX 7900 XT did see a slight performance uplift, but not the same astronomical lift we saw with the others. It actually fell in line after the two Ti's. As for what specifically is causing the issues in our test bench, we can't really speculate. What we have done though is we've reached out to both Intel and Nvidia to let them know what we experienced. What we do know with a bit more certainty is that Indiana Jones is poised to be update while we're writing and filming this video. So this could all change, or this could just be a quirk with how some games and configurations of hardware play in the sandbox together. Okay, back to performance. Moving on to 1440p, we see the RTX 5070 Ti's performance take a 9.7 average lead over its predecessor while leading the 7900 XT by an average of 9.1%. That is, if we're including the funky Indiana Jones numbers in there. It actually looks a little bit more like a 15% overall average lead if we take that out. At 1440p, we see Cyberpunk, Forza, and Wukong continue to expand their generational lead over the 4070 Ti Super while inviting Indiana Jones into the double digit percentage uplift club. Personally, I think it's because Indy has a fancy hat. The one place the 5070 Ti couldn't quite wrest control was in Space Marine 2. One might say the 4070 Ti still has an iron hand here. When we start adding in upscaling, the RTX 5070 Ti continues trending towards higher overall performance than its predecessor, but this time the average lead was around 6.4% overall. Interestingly, this was where the 5070 Ti took a monstrous 38% average lead over the 7900 XT, but that number isn't without its own story. At 1440p, with DLSS enabled, the 5070 Ti held on to games like Forza, Indiana Jones, and Cyberpunk, while Hogwarts and Space Marine 2 ended up leaning toward the 4070 Ti Super. Again, it's Modern Warfare 3 that continues to be a holdout for the 7900 XT. But with no FSR support in Indiana Jones and a significant difference in performance uplift between DLSS and FSR in the games we tested, the 5070 Ti just dominated here. When we add DLSS frame generation and AMD's fluid motion frames to our upscaling tests, the 5070 Ti did not let off the gas. Here we saw total leadership in this segment for the 5070 Ti over the 4070 Ti Super by an overall percentage average of 11.9%. Generationally, we saw the biggest performance increase versus the 4070 Ti in Forza, Modern Warfare 3, and Wukong. We also saw Space Marine 2 and Hogwarts land in the 5070's favor, though Hogwarts was a close call. On the other side of the aisle, the absence of fluid motion frames and FSR put the comparison to the 7900 XT in a weird place. From what we're seeing, COD still loves AMD, but DLSS frame generation, even at 2X, was way too much for the 7900 XT to compete with. Just a real quick note here on power draw and thermal performance. We saw the 5070 Ti cap out at 300 watts under load in Furmark, and on average around 261.9 watts in our gaming benchmarks. When compared to the 4070 Ti Super, the 5070 Ti did draw a little bit more power under full CPU load, but it drew less power on average than the 4070 Ti Super. Granted, this is an OC card, the 4070 Ti Super, that is, so this could explain the difference, but it's not a wild difference here. As for temperature, the 5070 Ti hovered around 66 degrees Celsius while under load and about 63 degrees while gaming. These numbers showed our 5070 Ti running slightly cooler under load than the 4070 Ti Super while holding gaming averages around the same temperature. As for noise level, Asus did a really good job with the cooling solution on their Prime RTX 5070 Ti. We recorded it around 56.1 decibels, so pretty quiet overall. Now that we've seen some comparative data, it's time to talk about how multi-frame generation works on the 5070 Ti. As we're getting to know more about DLSS multi-frame generation, what we're looking for is a GPU's ability to run at around 50 to 60 frames per second or higher with the settings you want enabled before DLSS and multi-frame generation are introduced. This is like Nvidia's, like, you must be this tall to ride measuring stick for the multi-frame generation carnival. Like, I don't know if you've ever had to deal with that. I know that I have not, but here we are. So how did the 5070 Ti do? Well, with multi-frame generation at 4X, we saw around 243 frames per second in Alan Wake 2. In Cyberpunk 2077, 305 frames per second. We saw an average of 334 frames per second from Dragon Age Veilguard, around 198 in Hogwarts Legacy, and 275 in Marvel Rivals. With the exception of Hogwarts Legacy, which would be fine on a different platform, all these games landed above 60 frames per second before DLSS and multi-frame generation were introduced, with Cyberpunk riding the line. We couldn't quite take the turn on all of the features approach here in Cyberpunk because the performance hit at ray tracing overdrive landed the 5070 Ti too far below that 60 frames per second threshold at 1440p. That being said, if Cyberpunk isn't your jam, but one of these other games is, the yet to be seen RTX 5070 non-Ti might be able to hit that mark with how far above 60 FPS the 5070 Ti landed in raw performance, if it follows the trend we're seeing in the 50 series so far. Right now, the 5070 Ti is looking like the you must be this tall to ride GPU for 1440p, while the 5080 and really more reliably the 5090 serve as the entry point for solid multi-frame generation at 4K. We've talked about a lot of data. So where does all of this leave us with the RTX 5070 Ti? Especially considering our opening statements. Overall, the RTX 5070 Ti continues to occupy the same space as its predecessor. This is the GPU for the enthusiast who isn't ready to drop those RTX 5080 dollars on a GPU, but still wants strong 1440p performance, as well as access to Nvidia's 50 series feature set. Though some of those partner cards are looking like they're starting to try on the 5080's price tag for size, which is really weird. If the prices of this GPU do reach that $900 level or above, the 5070 Ti is really, really hard to recommend. Also, keep in mind that we've seen this before with other launches where prices have inflated and there's scarcity, but then the market calms the heck down. On the same token, if you're looking at those $900+ prices and considering spending that money, are there places where you could save a few dollars and try to get an RTX 5080 at MSRP? I know that no one likes to be told to wait or to be patient, But Jay actually made a valid point in his video about the 5070 Ti prices when he said that paying inflated prices for stuff like this sends a message that we, the consumer, are willing to pay inflated prices. And I don't know about you, but that's not me. There is a world where prices settle and where supply becomes more available. And if you're thinking of spending $900 on this GPU, wouldn't it be better to wait to snag a 5080 at $999? Or if you don't want to spend that kind of money, you literally do not have to. This GPU isn't going to be some miracle, magical boon of performance over its 40 series counterparts. We're seeing a lot of the same trend throughout the 50 series though. Some performance uplift in the 10 to 20% region over the previous generation. It's not as much as we hoped for, but are we ever really satisfied with performance uplift? I don't think so. The RTX 5070 Ti is a solid 1440p card if you can get it at the MSRP price. But like anything else, you need to determine if it's right for you based off of the information you have, the timing, your needs, and the current market price. And hopefully by this point, you feel a bit more armed to make that decision than you did before. And there you have it, our initial review of the RTX 5070 Ti. But this won't be the last time that you see the RTX 5070 Ti or Nvidia's RTX 50 series family. Did the 5070 Ti meet your expectations? What did you think of it as a potential RTX 4080 alternative? And if you picked one of these up for yourself, what do you think of it so far? And were you able to get it at MSRP? I hope you were. Let us know down in the comments below. And while you're down there, go ahead and slap that subscribe button, whip that like button, and ring that notification bell so that you get a notification each and every time we post a video like this one right here on Robeytech. And if you want to continue the conversation, talk about the questions we ask in videos like these, or ask questions of your own, head over to our Discord. That's discord.gg/Robeytech. It's an amazing place to talk to other tech and PC enthusiasts about stuff like this. And hey, you know what? You might just make a friend while you're there. Also, make sure you follow us on Robeytech at all of our socials, on all of the social media platforms. And if you made it this far in the video, I just want to say a heartfelt thank you for sticking around with me throughout this video. And I look forward to seeing you on the next one.